Good evening, ladies and gentlemen. Welcome to another Wednesday. 2 hours of nothing but fun with me, Mandy Parsons, and John Moreland on the PM show. We're so glad to have you here this week. John, are you there?
I'm here.
It's so good to have you back, my illustrious co-host.
Yes, I hope the show is exciting as you promised, because I need to pick me up. It's been a long week. I know, what is it? What's today, Wednesday? I should know that. It's Wednesday, but it's been a long week trying to make money in this government economy.
Well, I'm a public school teacher. We've been around that several times. I am not working right now because this summertime.
Summertime. It should be a time to relax. And enjoy yourself.
It should be, but I'm worried about job interviews and finding a gig, if you will, for next year. So we'll see what happens. I have 2 interviews tomorrow.
Well, good luck with that. You know, I remember. I met a guy one time who told me, he said, you know, it's funny. He's like, I always wanted to travel, but either I had the money because I was working so much but didn't have the time, or I wasn't working so I had plenty of time but I didn't have the money. So I always think about that. It's like, I think that's the way most Americans feel most of the time. You either got the time or the money, but you never have both at the same time. That's the trick.
Unless you're our president who says that, people, you're just going to have to cut back on vacations if the economy is that bad. We're going to take your money and we're going to spend it and we're going to go around the world and my wife is going to rack up millions of dollars worth of charges and fees, staying in posh hotels on your tax dollar.
Don't worry. It was only like $150,000 for a couple nights stay. I mean, you know, that's nothing.
Well, yeah, but that's only one trip.
Oh, man. I can't – you know, it's so funny, the avarice of these people, just this insatiable desire to spend other people's money. It blows my mind. They can go and spend – I think it was like literally like $150,000 on a couple nights hotel stay. And they can say this is necessary with a straight face. It never seems to amaze me at the gall that these people have. I mean, it's – have you ever seen the show – oh, geez. It's the new one with Kevin Spacey. I've been watching. I'm on season 2. I'm almost done.
I have not seen it.
House of Cards?
No, you mentioned that before. I still have yet to watch it. I don't have cable.
Well – you always have the internet and torrents, but I didn't say that.
So
talk to me after the show. I'll give you all the secrets. Go to torrents.com and get it for free. Anyways, the show is really great. I'm like on, I don't know, episode 10, I think, of season 2. I don't know. I got 3 episodes left. It's gotten really, really good. But still, so far, my favorite line the entire show is at the end of season 2, episode 6. When Kevin Spacey looks at this, he's a man of industry, and he says, you may have all the men with money, but I have all the men with guns. And I love that quote. It's like, did Libertarian write the show? I mean, it's crazy. But
yeah.
I mean, that to me is exactly the way it is. But it's a great show. You should watch it. And Kevin Spacey is brilliant, as he always is.
I will certainly have to check that out. You know, I've been – I don't know. It doesn't sound like something I would want to watch, but I have been pleasantly surprised in the past, so I'm certainly willing to give it a try.
You should try it. I mean, he is the dirtiest, sleaziest politician you can imagine, but that's kind of what the show's about. All of them are dirty and sleazy politicians. It's very realistic.
Are you sure that it's a fictional show and not reality TV?
I think the only thing fictional on there is people get killed. I think everything else is real, though.
That's still not fictional.
I know. But, you know, like, we see main characters killing other people, and so I don't want to give anything away. So, but, yeah, it's a good show.
I will say this. I found this article just, like, a few minutes before our show started, and I didn't have any intention of covering this, but when I read it, it was really, really important. As a student with a bachelor's degree in media or mass communications, something that turned media on its head when it first came out was YouTube. I mean, because YouTube virtually can make anybody a star overnight. And I think we saw that with the likes of, I hate to mention it, but Justin Bieber. Justin Bieber was discovered on YouTube. I wouldn't necessarily say he's talented, but I would say that he's a star. We cannot deny that. So I came across this article that said that YouTube is about to delete independent artists from its site. Now, I read another article that said, oh, relax, they're not going to delete the independent artists. But apparently YouTube is about to set up a pay system where it's a premium service. And if you want to watch some of your favorite videos, they said you can download the songs as well, that you're going to have to start subscribing to this premium service to be able to do that. You know, right now you can get on YouTube and you can watch anything that you want to, basically, that's on there. So you can see shows that you missed on television, and you can listen to videos or watch videos that usually you'd watch on MTV if they ever played music videos again. But this is a huge deal. What do you think about this?
Well, you know, I just saw the article when you posted it, and I have to say, I think some of these services have tried these two-tier systems where you have a free section and then you have, you know, this premium subscriber. I don't know if that really works. I mean, YouTube's going to have to figure out whether for their model it actually works and people are willing to pay for it. A lot of times what happens, and this is why TV has been, you know, free for all these years and radio has been free, is because people aren't willing to actually shell out the dollars, but they'll tolerate listening to some ads. And so, and even YouTube's got ads. The problem that YouTube runs into, though, if you know what you're doing, there's a little browser extension called Adblocker. And if you add that to your browser, then you can block all the ads on YouTube. So they have a very specific problem. But, you know, who knows? I mean, you know what I always say? Let the market figure it out. If people reject YouTube and reject paying and YouTube takes losses, then that's good. That tells YouTube something. It tells them what not to do. My feeling is that that's what's going to happen. And maybe they'll have premium content, but maybe they'll end up doing a show like House of Cards, which Netflix has exclusively. So maybe they'll do something like that and to attract people to the premium service, that they can watch a particular show only on YouTube. Who knows?
This program is going to be called YouTube Music Pass, and they're doing this to compete with Spotify, Beats Music, iTunes Radio, Samsung's Milk, and Amazon Prime Music. Now, my brother subscribes to Amazon Prime because
well, Prime
they offer
just
a
got
lot
into
of,
it. Prime was
right,
just video before, and now they're doing audio.
My brother, he actually has a Prime account, and he uses it because the television shows that they offer are top-notch. I mean, not top-notch as in the best stuff out there, but they offer such a variety. It's got a lot of educational programs that they like to show my niece. So he already has an account, and other people who have an account, they have been very excited about this new Amazon Prime. Now, I know for Amazon Prime, you have to pay like $100 a year. It's pretty expensive, but everybody who's using it says that they love it.
Well, it's actually, I don't know if it's that expensive. If you broke that down monthly, it's not too much monthly. But my sister actually has a service because she's got two small boys, my two little nephews, which I've talked about before, my two little Tasmanian devil nephews. So she has it, and they can watch stuff on there. But the other thing Amazon Prime does, which is kind of cool, they bundle a free shipping service with it. So if you buy something off Amazon and you have Amazon Prime, you get free shipping with it. So it's not just the video service. So now you're going to have a video service, music service, and free shipping for $100 a year. Sounds like a pretty good deal to me. I mean, I don't do it because I don't order that much stuff off Amazon. But if I ordered more stuff off Amazon and I was into the streaming, I would definitely consider it.
Now, I do want to remind people that we have a chat room. We would always love to hear the ideas, the opinions, and the comments about anything that we're talking about. Go to freedomizerradio.com and log into the chat room powered by Bark. Just create a username and a password and join us in there. I'm in there right now. I don't think John's in there. Or you can always call the number, and we will put you on the air with us, 347-324-3704. Now, John, the next thing, though, that I thought about with this article is that with the way that you and I feel, we feel that government has too much control over our lives. we don't think that government should be intruding so much as it is, and increasingly they're trying to intrude even more. We do have laws in place to protect artists from having their songs ripped off. So how does that play into the grand scheme of wanting a smaller government?
Well, you know, there's a debate among a lot of libertarians, some big L, some little L, and I fall more on the side of an extremely limited, if at all, and I would actually be comfortable with no intellectual property and no patents. And the reason for this is, and this is the big debate, you have those who are more of the Randians, the Ayn Rand types, who are very strong pro-patent, pro-intellectual property, and they lay out a case for that. They believe if you create something in your mind, you ultimately own it. The other case for it is, and I'm really summing up here, is that by allowing the government to put in a patent and a copyright system, you're basically allowing for a government-mandated monopoly, which requires state coercion. So, and even Rothbard talked about this, and for New Liberty, he talked about copyrights and patents, and a lot of libertarians, especially the big L libertarians, are against copyrights and patents. My only concern is if you do create something with your mind, you should be able to profit from it. In my viewpoint, there would be an extremely limited copyright and patent system. It would be for a limited amount of time. Anyone who is benefiting from the copyright and patent system would have to bear the entire cost of whatever that system is through user fees. So, for example, right now, the patent and copyright system is really a welfare system because me and you pay taxes and we don't have any patents. Do you have any patents, Amanda?
Not that I know of.
Laying around? Not that you know of. Okay. So you don't have any patents laying around. You don't have any intellectual property that you filed for. No copyrights. But yet we, through taxes, pay for the enforcement of copyrights and patents, which I think is illegitimate. And that's basically what the music industry and the film industry has been doing for years, suing people for downloading. Now, the other thing I kind of have a problem with is if you take something that's someone else's idea and then you turn around and you sell it and you make profit from it, I think that's a gray area. Now, am I for state coercion to stop that? Not necessarily. Well, probably not at all. But does it make me somewhat uncomfortable? Yes. But I think I err on the side of liberty, and so I'd rather say, well, I could live with a world that didn't have copyrights and patents, but I definitely don't think that we should be paying for them. People should bear the entire cost of it, and especially kids who are downloading, you know, the latest 50 Cent song. Is 50 Cent still popular? Is he still around?
Sort of. Probably. They call him 50 Cent. 50 Cent.
Oh, sorry, mispronounced. Yeah, I'm not up with the pop culture of today. But, you know, these kids, they got these 16-year-old kids. I mean, let's be real about this. They got these 16-year-old kids downloading music. And a few years ago, they were suing these kids for $100,000 because they downloaded 5 crappy songs. You know, so I think we've gone a little crazy with the copyright and patent system. And, you know, it's stifling innovation. This actually brings us right into another point or another story I wanted to talk about was that Elon Musk, who is the CEO of Tesla Motors, has just released all the Tesla Motors, the electric car patents, for fair use. As long as you'll use the patents to further the electronic car infrastructure, then they won't sue you for using them. They're open to the public now. Anyone can see them, which is fantastic. Well, but I think he exemplifies this trend or this idea that, hey, patents aren't necessarily a good thing. They stifle innovation, and they create monopolies. I'm sorry. Go ahead.
Well, I was going to say there are other people in the music industry who feel the same way that you do. I know that David Bowie offers all of his music for free to download because he says if you like my music enough, you will go out and purchase it. And I tend to agree with him. And I have friends who say the same thing. They're like, well, we download it to listen to it and see if we like it. And then if we like it, we go out and support the artist. So David Bowie, he says the same thing. He is not proprietary with his music at all. So, you know, way to go, David Bowie. It's the same as what you're talking about with Tesla. I did glance over the Tesla article. Tell us more about it.
Well, I mean, that's pretty much the gist of it. He's going to open it up. Now, I would like to see a lot more of the patents open up. There's been ideas over the years to have dead patent legislation that says, okay, if a company doesn't use a patent within so many years, it's considered a dead patent and it's open source. at that point. That would be an interesting idea. Now, granted, some anarchists aren't going to be happy with that, that idea. They would rather just see the patent office, you know, abolished. And I, honestly, I wouldn't, you know, I wouldn't mind living in a world like that. But hopefully this is a trend that will continue. But I think you've got too many of these entrenched businesses who make way too much money. I mean, look at Microsoft, for example. Microsoft sucks. Everybody who has Windows complains about it. The only reason they've existed for as long as they have is because of their copyrights and patents. You know, I mean, like, for example, they get a fee from every Android device that's activated because they claimed that there was a line of code or a couple lines of code that was used in the Android operating system that goes on most people's Google phones if you don't have an Apple iPhone, and which I have a Galaxy S3 by Samsung, and it runs the Android system. Well, they claimed that that it infringed on Microsoft patents, so basically Google went into a deal with Microsoft to pay them a fee every time, a large fee, every time someone activated an Android device. Well, that's not helping innovation. That's just lining the pockets of Microsoft. And so we see a lot of that kind of stuff. And we also see where we end up getting into patents where someone creates something but they don't patent it. So then someone else turns around. It's not their idea. They turn around and they patent it. And then they sue the person who originally created it. So you've got all this abuse of patents right now that's going on. But nobody really talks about it because I think people don't see it. It's not like in front of their face, and it's not something they believe affects them. But if we got rid of the copyright and patent system, you would see a wave of innovation in this country. And these companies that have become lazy and that have decided not to innovate, they would either have to, like Microsoft, produce better products, or they'd go out of business. But, of course, they want to keep the current system because it keeps them entrenched. So it benefits
them. Well, and if we had no patent system like you're talking about, think of how the past would have been affected. I mean, we had a situation where Alexander Graham Bell beat another person to the punch for the telephone just by a fraction of time. And there was somebody else who created the same system. Had he gotten there first, he would have received the patent. Then we have the situation with Thomas Edison and Nikola Tesla. So if – I mean, history would have been turned on its – side if we
well,
had...
no, you bring up a good point. I mean, who is the patent office to decide who invented this first? I mean, how do they know? They only know who filed it first. That's all they know.
Exactly. So, like I said, history would have been turned on its side if we didn't have this in place. But, you know, there I do believe that people's ideas should be protected. I'm not sure about patents and so forth, though, because like you said, just because somebody seeks out a patent doesn't mean that they were the first to come up with it. So it's a gray area, and I see where you're coming from. I agree with 99.9% of what you're saying. It's just like you said, it's a gray area.
Yeah, it is, but, it, you know, it's something I think we need to talk about. It's like if we had a real debates every 4 years, presidential debates or whatever, they would actually talk about these sorts of issues. But if you notice, I mean, when's the last time a presidential candidate has brought up copyrights and patents? And the main reason is because all the companies funding him, they love the copyright and patent system.
Well, and they love a lot of other things that the government has control over. It's getting absolutely out of control with how much they want to invade our lives.
Well,
what?
You know, this is something I was trying to – they like handouts. This is something I was trying to explain to someone the other day. They said, well, why do people do this? And you know, how do they benefit from this? Like, we were talking about inflation and money printing. And so the example I gave was, I was like, what you need to understand is that you have concentrated benefits versus dispersed cost. For me and you and everybody else, it cost us $10 more on our taxes. Now, we're not going to, you know, get pitchforks and march on Washington over $10. But that $10 added up over all these people may end up meaning that some crony capitalist company gets a $10 billion subsidy. Well, for them, they're going to continue to lobby. It's in their interest. It's a concentrated benefit, and it's a dispersed cost. And it's the same way with inflation. When the government prints money, the government printed, say, $10 million and gave it to me and you, and they said, Amanda, John, here's $10 million. You guys have a great time. We'd be like, all right, awesome, because we benefit from that. So we're going to benefit – we're going to have the $10 million. And then when we spend that money in the economy and you have the commensurate rise in prices, everyone else will pay for it. And most people will be completely unaware that we just stole $10 million. They would have no idea. But But that's really how it works, because we get the money first because we're connected to the government. We spend it while the money is worth the most, and it's worth less after we spend it, because now you've got $10 million extra dollars in the economy. You've got the same amount of goods, or you've got more money chasing the same amount of goods, and so you end up with a rise in prices. But that takes time to happen. It's called the velocity of money. So it takes time. But most people aren't even aware that this is happening to them. They just think, man, it sucks. My paycheck doesn't go as far as it used to. That's most people's reaction.
Oh, isn't that the truth? And I'll tell you, we do have a lot more to talk about. I'm going to go ahead and send us off to our first commercial break. I hope you guys will stay tuned.
Sweet.
We'll be right back.
My name is Dr. Eric Norman. I have studied vitamin B12 deficiency for over 35 years. I have developed the urinary MMA test to detect tissue B12 deficiency early, allowing treatment and prevention of permanent disability. B12 deficiency can cause anemia, but also neurologic problems such as spinal cord degeneration, paranoia, and dementia. B12 is found only in animal sources, so vegetarians become deficient. As people age, they may not produce enough stomach acid or intrinsic factor protein for absorption of B12 and become deficient. Up to 10% of seniors may have a normal serum B12 level, but a tissue B12 deficiency causing a 3 times greater risk for heart attack, stroke, or Alzheimer's. For more information, visit B12.com.
Are you dedicated to ending the New World Order? Well, it's time to make way for Spontaneous Order. Hi, I'm Eric Bell, host of Freedomizer Radio's new hit show, For Whom the Bell Tolls, where you will hear current events from a volunteer's perspective, philosophical libertarianism, and a roadmap to a free and stateless society. Tune in every Tuesday at 3 to 5 p.m. Pacific and 6 to 8 p.m. Eastern.
Thank you for listening to Freedomizer Radio. This is Jen Coffey, your host of the Knives, Lipstick, and Liberty Show. Join the conversation every Friday at 3 p.m. Eastern Time. This is Jen Coffey, thanking you for listening to FreedomizerRadio.com.
Lindsay Williams on Freedomizer Radio.
Truth Negative, I love the title that you use on your radio. I've thought about it ever since we talked on off of the air the other day, and I'd say that that's an excellent title for a talk show host.
There is a new program on the Freedomizer Network, Bloody Beak Radio, punching the New World Order in the nose. Bloody Beak Radio is here to inform you on a wide variety of topics revolving around current and recent events. The main thrust of the show is not just to inform you of the problems we face, but rather, how do we analyze them in a way that we can use to create counter-propaganda and use that knowledge in our everyday lives. In a sense, how do we market the truth? Bloody Beak Radio will give you the tools to win the information war so we can destroy the barriers that divide the people and have a peaceful revolution. Join your host, Kyle Baker, on Sunday evenings to have an honest discussion about how to win the numbers game and ensure that we decide the tipping point, not them.
This is Cindy Lake. Please listen to me on Freedom Talk with Cindy Lake at 5 o'clock Pacific Standard Time, 8 o'clock Eastern Standard Time on FreedomizerRadio.com. All the issues that are important to you, like Common Core, Agenda 21, Fully Informed Jury Association, 10th Amendment, 2nd Amendment, 4th Amendment, 3rd Amendment, the Constitution. See you at FreedomizerRadio.com, 5 p.m. Pacific Standard Time. 8 p.m. Eastern Standard Time. See you there.
Come listen to Ancient of Days, where we talk about the lies, misrepresentations, and holes in the history we learned in school. Mondays, 3 p.m. Pacific Time, only on Freedomizer. Thank you.
Okay, and we're back. John Moreland.
Yeah, what happened to the bumper music there? Just curious.
We didn't do bumper music.
Oh.
So.
Well, I like hearing Harris. I know it's time to come back.
Well, you can hear my lovely voice say, "Welcome back, John Moreland."
It's just as wonderful. Okay.
It's just as wonderful.
Actually,
but,
I need to cut up a few more of his songs and do them for do the bumper music. But he has another album. He's about to, I think, finish. So, I need to contact him and say, "Hey, where's the new album?"
Yeah, why don't you go ahead and plug him? Because as people who listen know, we have just started syndicating our show on the Voluntary Virtues Network, which is a YouTube channel. Speaking of that, I wonder how this new contract is going to affect our broadcasting on YouTube, but that's neither here nor there.
Shut us down.
You can find us on Thursdays from 4 to 6 Eastern Standard Time, the PM show on the Voluntary Virtues Network. We're quite excited about it. It's a big deal. We're on the network with some huge, huge names, like some of John's heroes. Walter Block.
Yes.
Michael Shanklin. Adam Kokesh. Stephen Molyneux.
Well, you know, we haven't talked about the Adam Kokesh story yet.
We haven't.
Now let's bring up Adam. We should.
But I wanted to bring this up to switch gears just slightly. And the only reason we don't talk about
Did you say Stephen Molyneux?
Yes.
Did you say Stephen Molyneux? Okay, good.
I did.
Stefan's probably – he's probably – I love – have you ever listened to any of his videos or and been to his site or anything?
No, I've heard him a little bit. I've heard him on clips. I've heard some of – read some of articles that mention him and his ideas. But, no, I haven't.
He's an interesting guy.
In French.
What, you know what I love about him? He talks about philosophy, and he talks about it with such clarity – and then at the same time, he's funny as hell. He is so funny. You have to watch his videos. I mean, sometimes he gets very serious, but he's really entertaining, and he's, like, deeply philosophical. It's a strange mix, but it works. I mean, I love his stuff.
And just really quickly.
People should go give him money, FYI.
Or people can give me money. I will take money.
Or they can – well, no. Stefan is actually that's his full-time gig now. That's what he does. And so if people watch his videos and they like his stuff, they should give – I've contributed to his site. About 12 or 18 months ago, and forgive me if I'm wrong here, but he did find out that he had cancer. And so not that that's a reason to give to him or anything, but I think it is. I mean, I think especially when people bring value to your life, and I think especially in a free society, which is what I think most people that listen to us want is a free society, then we should support those people who produce things in which we find use. And I think that definitely includes art and you know, the sciences and philosophy and people who produce things that we can enjoy and that we need. So. That's it. That's the end of my soapbox. I'll get off my soapbox.
I'll
get back on
you.
Later.
On
don't worry.
Accounts. Oh, I'm sure you will, but that's okay. We welcome that here on the PM show because we always like to shake things up and stay funky. So anyway.
So what's
next? Like I was saying, we don't usually talk about entertainment on the show in the sense of what's on television, what is broadcasting. But this, I know this is a topic that both you and I immensely enjoy. Diehard fan here. I don't know how diehard you are, but coming from the great state of Georgia where the show is filmed, I am a Walking Dead fanatic. Love the show. And I know you do too.
Yeah, you know, it's been a good series. I started watching it, I think, right after the first season finished. Yeah, I watched it. I downloaded every episode and watched every episode. I think I watched it in like 5 days or something crazy. I couldn't stop watching it. It was crazy. But it's been a really good series. The only disappointment I have to say in the series is now that I'm thinking about it, I can't remember. Do you remember the guy in the second series who was kind of the conscience of the group? He was like, when they started to do something that he knew was morally wrong, he'd be like, wait a minute.
My favorite character, Dale. Dale.
Thank you. It was so my Dale was my favorite character, and I hope I'm not ruining anything. But Dale gets bitten, Let's just put it that way.
No, he doesn't get bitten. His stomach gets ripped open wide.
Well, okay. Well, I was trying to put it in a less graphic way.
But
they get him. Okay? That's what I was trying to do. But Dale was my favorite character. But, you know, Herschel kind of took Dale's place. So that's why I liked Herschel.
My next favorite character. Yeah, they keep – the beauty of the show is that that's what they said.
Are those really your two favorite characters? Those are my two favorite characters.
Okay, John Moreland, that's creepy. It's like the stars have aligned and the planets have aligned. You and I actually have the same favorite characters. I mean, that's huge for us. You and I butt heads a lot. We're not going to lie about that, even on the air. But we love each other to pieces, and we do a fun show.
Well, you know, I think it is. The attraction is that those guys were the moral center. They were the ones when, okay, it was easier because the mob wanted to hang someone out to dry. They were the one telling the group, no, 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 this isn't right. You can't do this. And I think as people who are of our persuasion are people who feel like, I mean, we have a moral conviction about what we believe. We're not just utilitarians. We're not just practical people who say, well, you know, maybe this freedom thing and individual liberty is a good idea because it has the best results. No, we believe in liberty and freedom because it's the moral. We make the moral case for it. We believe in natural rights, that people have a right to be free and not to be interfered with. And so I think that's, for me, I don't know if I should speak for you, but for me, that's my attraction to those characters. They're the ones saying, no, this is wrong.
That is precisely why I liked both of them. And they were so gentle. They were roughed up when they had to be, but they were gentle overall. And that's how
they were Dr. Paul.
Yes, exactly. Oh, my gosh.
They almost could have been. It's like somebody writing a character and they go, I'm going to write Ron Paul into a script with zombies. Here we go.
Ron Paul, the zombie fighter. I love it. I'd rather see that than Abraham Lincoln, vampire hunter.
Yes, I did not watch that.
I never saw the movie.
I missed that one, I have to say. I did miss that. But,
no,
you know, I did catch a new movie today.
Yes, and we will – oh, gosh, we will get into that at the end of the show. We're going to save that till the end of the show because I wanted to tell you some great news about The Walking Dead. I think you'll be thrilled.
Okay.
AMC and the geniuses that they are have decided that The Walking Dead is at least going to go for 12 seasons.
I don't know how I feel about that.
Well, if it follows the graphic novels, you're not going to have any issues. But, you know, some great characters have been created based off of just the creation of AMC and the people on the show with direct relation to the man who's writing the series. So they have his input. But in the series, the graphic novel, Daryl is not even a character. And in the graphic novel, Rick was the one who lost his hand. We know that that's not the case in the show. And I'm personally very excited for this. The only thing that does not excite me are the huge chunks of time between one season to the next and their mid-season breaks. I could watch this every single day.
Well, you know, what I was going to say, this is the reason I have mixed feelings. There's one of my other favorite shows, Game of Thrones, which I swear is written by another libertarian. I don't know if the guy is – he's an old fella, actually, but I don't know if he's libertarian or not. But, man, there's sometimes I'm watching the series and I'm like, this guy's got to be libertarian or whoever wrote that particular episode is. But, you know, my fear is the Sopranos fear. I loved the Sopranos. Sopranos went on for – they called it six seasons plus a bonus season, which was like a half season. But give or take, it was seven seasons. But I always thought that the Sopranos should have ended after five seasons. And even – not just the Sopranos, but other series I've watched. You get to season five and it's like everything is great. But then they try to drag stuff out, and it just doesn't work, and I'm concerned that – and I hope I'm wrong. I hope that they can, you know, they can do better than some of these other series writers, which I'm kind of confident they can because they've done such a great job so far, and I'm stoked about next season. But we'll have to wait and see. And I feel the same way about Lost. Lost was great for five seasons, and then it kind of was like, eh. Last couple seasons wasn't so good.
Well, if you can imagine, the graphic novel apparently has a character in it that is worse than the governor. And if they're going to follow the storyline and make it horrendous and add some flavor, even more flavor to the show, then they're going to introduce this character. I won't say much about him. I don't know much about him, but he is supposed to be worse than the governor, if you can imagine.
Well, you know, I was very excited when the governor got the axe.
So was I. And the shameful part is
he didn't really get the axe, but, you know.
I watched The Talking Dead after The Walking Dead, and these people are so nice. The characters that are so mean and evil are so nice.
Oh, yeah. I've seen some of the specials on HBO for the Game of Thrones. And, like, there's some characters that are just wretched, and you hate their guts. And then they're, like, the nicest, you know, actors. But that's what they do. They're paid to pretend, you know. That's what they do. And if they're good at it, then you hate them because you're supposed to.
Yes, they're very, very good at what they do. And
12 seasons.
I think that I don't want to fill up 2 hours talking about nothing but The Walking Dead, which I think both of us, could successfully do. So I think we'll switch gears a little bit here. Let's talk
but
about –
But before we do that, are you excited about the next season?
Of The
like
Walking
Dead? Like the direction
Dead?
They can take this. Yeah.
I cannot wait. My parents and I sometimes don't get along.
I've got so many ideas in my head of what it's going to be.
My parents and I sometimes don't get along, but there's not a Sunday you won't see me at somebody's house watching The Walking Dead, and it's usually at my parents' house. So it is a Sunday ritual for us, and come October, I hope we're getting along because I'm going to go to their house.
I wish I knew more people around here who watch The Walking Dead. I would have Walking Dead parties. It'd be kind of awesome.
Yes. And I would come to those parties, and it would be every Sunday, and you'd be like, come on, I already broadcast with you on Wednesdays. Get out of my house.
No, Walking Dead's a fun hour. It really is. The funniest thing about it is I never watch it live.
You know I have to watch it the night it comes out. I refuse.
No,
refuse to
I avoid social media for a day. I refuse to, like, look at any site who I think might say something about the show, and I normally watch it on Monday or Tuesday night.
Oh, my gosh. Well, yeah, you would have to stay away from my Facebook page. I talk about it
sometimes. Well, I'd have to order HBO.
Well, like I said, I don't have cable. I go to my parents' house.
There are other ways to get The Walking Dead if you know where to go.
We're not going to talk about that again. I think somebody's already going to flag our show for some of the
things. If anybody wants to know, just message me. I'll be glad to help you, guide you, show you the way.
Hey,
anyway.
Which reminds me that you can always come into our to our website at freedomizerradio.com and join us at our chat room. There's a little chat tab off to the side. You can join us there. Or you can call in, share your opinions. Share your thoughts, your comments at 347-324-3704. We will always welcome guests. So now we're going to switch up a little bit. John, did you know that our president never tells the truth?
I would actually be shocked if we ever elected anyone who told the truth. So I go into it thinking they're a liar.
Well, how would you feel if I said, I'm President Obama, and we're not sending any more troops to the Middle East?
Excuse me?
How would you feel if I said that?
Now, if you were Ron Paul, I would be in the front row cheering. But since you're not Ron Paul, that means you're probably a liar.
Yes, and unfortunately, the same president who said, we're not sending any more troops to the Middle East, has now announced right after that he's sending over 275 U.S. military personnel to Iraq.
Don't worry, citizen, though.
Support.
It's not his fault. I mean, it's never his fault, you know. And all on another note about Dr. Paul, the only reason I trusted Dr. Paul is because he said the same thing for 30 years. So that's why I trusted him. He had a track record.
Oh, but you're supposed to listen to them for 31 years, not just 30.
Wow. All right, I know my standards are a little lax, but, you know, this whole thing about us being out of Iraq is baloney anyways, because CIA is still there. You know that other people are still in there from the United States government. You know, I mean, we don't know this, but we can assume, and You know, besides that, if they want to, they hit a button and send a drone. So we're everywhere all the time. I mean, they have the NSA. They can spy on anybody they want, including foreign diplomats and, you know, foreign leaders, quote-unquote leaders. I hate calling people leaders because I didn't elect them, and probably half the people that live in their country didn't elect them. But, you know, we can – and then on top of that, we can just send a drone. So we're everywhere all the time.
We created this mess. And if they think that they can just go in, liberate, give Iraq all the power to change their own country and then back off, it's obviously not – it's not true. It's not happening. It leaves too much room for any group to take over. And as we have shown – we just created a chaotic mess, and now we have to, quote-unquote, go and clean it up. But we're not really cleaning anything up. They didn't have the intention of pulling out, and they didn't have the intention of keeping us out of the Middle East. They had every intention of a scenario like this happening so we could send more troops over and keep fighting all around the world.
So do you think that the invasion of Iraq was more destabilizing to that region? I mean, that's where I fall. I mean, I don't know if you are the same –
We hung a man, supposedly hung a man, who was a dictator to this country. What did he do to us? This is one of those things that Ron Paul would say, unless they deliberately attack us or threaten to attack us, stay out of it. We should have stayed out of Iraq completely. We had no business going over there. It's not our job to police the world. And we're not even policing the world anymore. We are just – our military are robots that get sent over to these places, and they're doing the job they signed up for. Unfortunately, the job they signed up for is not really what they signed up for. So we're using the military. He's abusing our military. I mean, cutting them down to two meals a day when prisoners get more food than that. It's – absurd. We just need to bring our people home and stay out of other people's business. But they want a one-world government.
Yeah, I mean,
government.
I would agree. I would agree with that. Basically, just stay out of it.
The only way to create this one-world government that they want is to take everything over. So that's what they're trying to do.
Well, I think the only problem with the one-world government is we've got too many maniacs running all the different monopoly territories, which we call countries. And so we got too many maniacs running the monopoly territories to give up power to one person, I think, or one entity. So I guess I'm not one of these people who think that we'll ever end up with a one world government. We got too many maniacs. But they will individually, I'm sure, try to amass as much wealth and power and as they possibly can. And I think with Iraq, we just made a huge mistake interfering with that country. We destabilized that entire region. I mean, the region wasn't stable anyways, let's be honest. But, you know, it's one of these things where I don't understand how the majority opinion, and I don't know if it's the majority opinion of people, that I'm doubtful of, but of the politicians especially, the majority opinion is that we should be the policemen of the world. That just baffles me. I really just don't get it.
Well, the other thing that is unfair is that the people around the world look at the people of our country and they criticize us, they put us down, and there's a deep hatred for the citizens of our country because people look at our government and say, stupid Americans, we can't stand them. I can't tell you how many foreigners that I've talked to who hate Americans because of our government. And because the media is not broadcasting things going on in this country, the people around the world don't know that we're fighting. They think we're just sitting back and watching this horrible government, and before long it's going to come to a head and we're all going to be fighting. And I hate it because it gives the world a terrible impression of who the people of the United States really are.
Yeah, you know, I think even if we got someone – like a Ron Paul elected, it would take a long time to repair some of the damage that's been done as far as diplomacy goes.
I'm not really sure that even if we got someone like Ron Paul elected that we could fix the damage. I think we'd have to break it down and build it all back up. And if somebody like Ron Paul got elected, I would be really afraid that somebody would try to kill him, assassinate him. That was a big concern on getting him elected when we were working for his grassroots movement.
Well, I mean, he was saying some stuff that definitely ruffled people's feathers that of course the establishment didn't like. I mean, he even acknowledged that the establishment called him and his supporters dangerous. I'm trying to remember, it was, what state did he, was it New Hampshire he came in second place? And he said that right after he won second place. Yeah, he said that right afterwards, and I was like, that kind of worries me. But, you know, irregardless, even if we had somebody who was kind of a pro-peace president, I think it would take them a long time to repair the damage that we've done around the world. And sadly, I think most Americans are completely oblivious to it. They've been so caught up in this kind of bloodthirsty rhetoric that it's kind of blinded them from any reason or logic. They've been told that there are people out there who might want to kill us, so we should go kill them first. And that's kind of been, I think that's kind of where we are, which I think is sad.
Well, let me ask you this. I had a friend tell me the other night that Ron Paul is a statist. He said Ron Paul is actually a statist. He's one of the better ones that was in government, but he's certainly still a statist. What do you think about that?
From an anarchist perspective, yeah, he is. I mean, he's a constitutionalist, so to an anarchist, he would be a statist. He would be much more friendly towards the anarchists than anyone else. But yeah, to them, Ron Paul is probably a little L libertarian. I would say that's probably the case.
This is what I say about Ron Paul. I think he knows that reducing government is the only option that we have. Like, his ideas are already considered radical to a lot of people. And I think that he knows that we won't be able to get down to an anarchy situation. And people have a drastically wrong definition of what anarchy is in the minds of the peaceful liberty folks.
Well, yeah, they equate it with chaos. And that's
right,
not what
exactly
anarchy means. It just means absence of the state. It doesn't mean there wouldn't be any natural law that would be enforced, or there wouldn't be any natural elites that would run society or order society, or there wouldn't be cooperatives that would organize society. There would be all sorts of different systems that would organize society, but no one would have a monopoly on violence. And so, you know, but now with you saying that, I'll ask you this question, because I'm really interested in what you would say. If Ron Paul realizes all that, so strategically he's like, well, I'm a constitutionalist because I'm already extreme enough. Good Lord, if I came out and said I was an anarchist, then they really wouldn't pay attention to me. What do you think about what Rand does? Because really, there are people I've met personally in the liberty movement. I'm not going to name any names, but they're well known in the liberty movement. And I've talked to them one-on-one, and they've said, listen, the basic idea here is strategy. It's politics, and Rand is playing politics because he truly, in his heart of hearts, is just like his dad, but he plays the game that his dad never would. And so people who would push him off to the side or would ignore him or discard him are wrong to do so, because what he's doing is strategy. What do you say to that?
Oh, I say I don't care. I don't really care what he's doing. I don't like what he's doing. I don't understand what he's trying to do. I don't think that he will make president. Sorry, I don't see it happening. And I think that the best thing to do at this point is to continue spreading his dad's ideas, because he is still in office. His dad retired, and I'm sure that his father knows of whatever he's doing or whatever his plan is. I have no doubt about that. Because at this point, if he was my son and I had worked that hard spreading the ideas that I had, I'd be disowning my son at this point. Quite honestly, I think I'd be disowning him. But I'll tell you, playing a game, he plays it too well. I think he's leaving a lot of us who followed his father's footsteps confused. I think that he is leaving us wondering what in the world is going on. And to me, that makes me very uncomfortable. He plays the game too well. I mean, he threw his support behind Mitt Romney. It was like a slap in the face to the liberty people.
No, I would tend to agree with you there. You know, I have mixed feelings about Rand because I want to believe that he's this good guy. And he's very affable. I mean, he's a very likable fella. But I think there's something to having this following that is more of a purist following to hardliners. And I think what's happening is the hardliners are getting pushed to the sides, just as, in all honesty, even during Ron Paul's 2012 campaign, I mean, Tom Woods has talked about this openly. He was pushed to the side by people who were like, no, you know, Ron can't be seen with you. He can't, you know, have these extremist viewpoints. And, you know, there were people who supported Ron Paul coming out a lot more hardcore than he did in the 2012 election. So, I don't know. We'll see what Rand's future holds. I mean, I wouldn't be surprised. I know I'm confident he's going to make a run for the White House. Now, whether the establishment would ever allow him to get the nomination, that's to be seen. I'm doubtful of that, though. Very, very doubtful.
Well, the other person that they're trying to throw their support behind is Ted Cruz. And I have never cared for Ted Cruz. I always looked at him and said, he is playing a game. I'm not really sure what his game is. But the thing about it is I found out just a few weeks ago, his wife is a bigwig for Goldman Sachs. Anybody who follows the whole problem with support and who's supporting who during campaigns, Goldman Sachs threw their support right behind Mitt Romney and Obama in the last election. And that was certainly just to make sure that their interests were fed during the election.
Mm-hmm.
So either person who gets in, they would be supporting Goldman Sachs. So the fact that his wife is a bigwig for Goldman Sachs just leads me to trust my gut on him and not throw my support behind him. And I can't tell you the number of establishment people who really believe that Ted Cruz is amazing.
Well, you know, I actually agree with you 100% on what you just said. My inclination towards Ted Cruz is there were some Liberty people excited about him. And so I checked Ted Cruz out, and every time I listen to him, he's so pious and just he's come off like a pompous ass. And so I never could – I was like, this guy's just – he's trying too hard. I don't believe him. He's not real. And, you know, Tom Woods the other day on his show came out and basically said, you know, that Ted Cruz is the worst on foreign policy. He's just another neocon. So, and I agree with Tom on that point. He is. He's shown to become – he is no different than any other neocons. He's just taken, I think, some of the Liberty language, sprinkled it into his campaign, and says, okay, I get some of the Liberty people, I get some of the Tea Party people, I get some of the neocons. And now I think maybe the Liberty movement has become a strategy where, they're just another special interest group.
But they know that we have our votes that they need, for those of who believe that voting
right.
is still an answer. They know that they need us. They wouldn't acknowledge it during the last election. We got blamed for Mitt Romney's loss. But I'd rather think, hey
Mitt Romney was warned. In Charleston, South Carolina, one of the guys from our office actually stood up and said to him, Mitt Romney, the Ron Paul movement is very, very important. And if you end up winning the nomination, you're going to need those votes. There's estimates that at least 10 to 20% of the party now is of that persuasion. What are you going to do about it? And he gave some, you know, half-assed answer, and it just really didn't, you know, and then what bugs me is this is supposedly the party of personal responsibility. But yet when they lose an election, they whine and cry and talk about how it's everybody else's fault. Do you remember in 1992 when George H.W. Bush lost and they all blamed it on Perot? You remember that?
Yes.
I don't know if you go that far back. Okay, I go that far back. But I was like, why are you whining? Ross Perot obviously pulled in votes from people who were disgusted with you. You should have done a better job of campaigning for those people. Don't whine and cry and try to blame everybody else when it doesn't go your way. But that's exactly what the Republican Party does. They pander and beg for votes, and then when it doesn't go their way, they cry.
Well, what people don't realize, why getting somebody stable for the country who doesn't want to send all the troops around the world and kill off everybody in the world, why this is important, not only because our troops are over there, but because it affects every single thing in our nation. And things like groceries will go up astronomically and our dollar will be worthless. I mean, this is in addition to the fact that the Federal Reserve keeps printing money with nothing to back it up. But, I mean, have you been to the grocery store lately? Meat and poultry, fish and eggs, they are expensive, very expensive.
Well, you know, the cost of the Iraq war alone, I think, was over $10 trillion. Is that right?
I don't remember.
I don't remember the exact number. It's massive. And we printed that money to pay for the Iraq war. Okay, let's see. I think it's $6 trillion. Expenses could grow more than $6 trillion. Okay, so it's around six. Who cares? Oh, my God. Once you get past a trillion, I can't even imagine that. But, no, you know, there was an article that we linked to price of meats and fish and everything else going up. But of course, if you read the article, they blame everyone but the Fed. Oh, it was, you know, just bad season. It was bad weather. It was whatever else. There's all these excuses. But the Fed never gets blamed. It just blows my mind when I read these articles and I'm like, the Fed's never mentioned. And it's like, have these people not ever thought that a massive increase in the money supply will affect prices? Maybe.
No, they don't. Awesome. You know, I was thinking the other day about what – there was an article, I think back during the election cycle of 2012, that Ron Paul came out and said, you all are complaining about gas prices, and gas is no more expensive than it used to be. The reason it's going up in price so drastically is because our dollar is worthless.
Oh, yeah. Well, you know, John Stossel did one of his specials, I think back when he was with ABC, and he priced – over a 20 or 30 year period, and price gasoline in gold didn't change. The price of gas, I mean, it fluctuated, but just minor fluctuations. It was basically the same. Then he did the same period with a dollar, and it went from 79 cents a gallon or whatever it was to over $4 at that time. But that had nothing to do, it had nothing to do with the price of oil. The price of oil was the same if you priced it in gold. The dollar was worth less. Like, a lot of people have this misconception that I go to the grocery store and everything costs more. No, you're getting it backwards. It doesn't cost more. What you're paying for it with is worth less. So the dollar you're giving them isn't worth as much, so they charge more. It's kind of like an exchange rate. If you went over to another country and your dollar wasn't worth as much as, say, the pound, you would have to pay more. It would cost you more in dollars. It's the same way when the government prints money and you go to the grocery store and you bought something that used to be a dollar and now it's $1.25. It didn't go up in price. What you're buying it with is worth less. And that's what people need to understand.
Yeah,
and
I saw
you can
meme.
Just thank the government for that.
I saw a meme going around that illustrated three shopping carts. And the first shopping cart was almost – it was completely full and it was overflowing a little bit. And they said 1970s, that would have cost you $20. Then they showed maybe 20 years later, a half-filled grocery cart, still $20. Then they went to 20 years later, which is closer to the time now, it had a few objects in the bottom of the cart. So it's really, you know, it's a good illustration of what's going on. And I just noticed that we're at the 8:03 mark. So we're going to go ahead and take our next commercial break, and we'll be back right after these messages.
This is Mercy. If you're listening to this message, warriors, you are the resistance. Warriors, you are not alone. There are pockets of resistance all around the planet. We are at the brink. Read about it in The Sovereign, newspaper of the resistance. Available now at newsstands everywhere. The Sovereign is a monthly 24-page tabloid newspaper featuring incendiary content about life during wartime in the age of Obama. Warriors, keep to date every month. Remember to read The Sovereign, newspaper of the resistance. Available at newsstands everywhere. This alert is for all you boppers out there in the big city. All you street people with an ear for the action. This is Mercy. If you're listening to this message, warriors, you are the resistance. This is Mercy. Mine will be the last voice you will ever hear. Don't be alarmed.
Greetings. This is Blake the Eccentric, and I want to invite you to check out my show on Freedomizer Radio,
The Eccentric Perspective,
featuring outside-the-box politics, philosophy, and gonzo journalism. Let's begin. But be warned, with knowledge comes responsibility, and you might not see the world the same way again as I attempt to open your mind, speak to your common sense, and challenge your critical thinking skills. So please join me as I cover the latest news and current events Monday, Wednesday, and Thursday at noon Pacific, 3 o'clock Eastern, only on Freedomizer Radio.
Hi, everyone. This is the Rose Colombo. Be sure to tune in every Monday, Wednesday, and Friday from 10:30 to noon Pacific Daylight Time and 1:30 to 3 p.m. Eastern Standard Time for the Justice Club on Freedomizer Radio. Grab a snack, grab a latte, grab a friend, or grab a stranger. I've been on the front lines for 25 years, and I've been labeled as the crusader for equal rights by the media many times. So join my crusade on the Justice Club at Freedomizer Radio every Monday, Wednesday, and Friday from 10:30 to noon Pacific Daylight Time and 1:30 to 3 p.m. Eastern Standard Time.
Oh, you want to heal the world? Oh, you can't do that. You know, you got to elect the right people. No, change your thinking. Change the way you feel. Change the way you do things. Do everything for peace. Like John Lennon said, walk for peace. You take a shower for peace. Do whatever you do for peace.
Every time you do that, you set a ripple effect out.
Because we live in a vibrational world, and your brain is the instrument. To learn how to direct and control your mind, you guys are superheroes. You know, they don't want you to know that, but you are. You guys are the most powerful people in the world.
We see the power in you to change your thinking. Monday, Wednesday, Friday, and Saturday, only on Freedomizer Radio.
And we're back. John Moreland, we are back.
Okay, I'll come back when I hear Harrison Ray. I'm signing off now.
Okay, well, I got it from here then. You're so wrong for that. Now
I'm muting myself.
No, don't do that. People need to hear John Moreland.
Need to hear Harrison Ray, too. Harrison
we'll be
Ray.
Playing. We'll play Harrison at the end of the show when it's time to go.
At the end? What's that about? Now, next break, when we go, we leave and come back.
I'll think about that. That way
we can get all his stuff in.
I'll think about it.
I will take control of that board. I will take control.
All right, let's go to an article before we have an all-out war on the air here. I read an article recently about Alaska bars offering pregnancy tests in bathrooms. And so apparently Alaska has one of the highest rates of fetal alcohol syndrome in the country. Very, very horrible disease, obviously, when people are drinking while they're pregnant. So the whole idea here is that they're going to put free pregnancy tests in the bathrooms for women, of course, not for men, of Alaska bars, so that before they start drinking, they can make sure they're not pregnant and that they're not harming a fetus that's in their body. Now, the thing is I would want to know personally why people don't know that they're pregnant. Responsibly, you should know whether or not you're pregnant. I know you don't have that issue, John, but responsibly, you should know whether or not you're pregnant, in my opinion. So offering free pregnancy tests, it's one of those just-in-case type things. But I don't know. I really don't know about this. What do you think?
This is weird. And when you originally told me about the story, I thought maybe it was, like, installed in the toilet or something and women weren't aware this was happening. But I take it they know this is happening, right?
Of course they know it's happening, yes. And they're trying, like I said, they're trying to do this
weird
to control fetal alcohol syndrome.
Drunk whores, go home.
Well, that's lovely.
No, that's just, it's tough love. I mean, I'm sorry, if you're running around a bar and you're whoring around and you're pregnant, go home. Stop whoring around. Just saying.
Well, and see, this is a little misleading. Because one article, this article says free pregnancy tests, but down here it's saying they're like $150 to $2 per pregnancy test. That is really cheap for these tests.
Must be government subsidized.
Well, this gentleman, Alaska State Senator Pete Kelly, is a vocal proponent of distributing the free pregnancy tests. It's not free. The article is now saying they're free, they're not, they're free, they're not. But he said he does not support distributing free birth control in bars. I don't think that a pregnancy test is birth control. It is a little too late at that point for birth control. So
just a little.
Yeah, just a little.
Who is this genius?
So,
did you say he was elected?
Yeah, he's Alaska State Senator Pete Kelly.
That explains it. These people that are elected are morons, okay? I mean, what? I don't even understand that. I'm blown away. I'm actually, I'm nearly speechless. I'm not speechless, but I'm nearly.
Well, in case the women take these pregnancy tests and find out that they are pregnant, hopefully the male has stuck around to help raise baby, we should probably talk about the rights for dads, okay? So they're putting these pregnancy tests in the bathrooms of bars so that these women can make sure they're not drinking while pregnant. Dads' bathrooms often lack diaper changing tables, and dads are battling for this. This makes sense to me. If dad's responsible, he's taking care of son or daughter, he should be able to take the baby in and have a changing table.
Now, on this story, now, do they want to mandate these?
Yes.
Is that
in
the
California,
deal?
In California, two bills would mandate equal access to changing stations in new public restrooms. This has been passed by the state Senate, and they're awaiting hearings in the state assembly. This is from June 13th, which was last Friday. So this is a really current article. And it says there are no state or federal laws that protect a man's right to do diaper duty. But this is my question. If this whole bill and getting passed by state government is simply to get diaper changing tables in restrooms for babies, why the heck do we need government intervention to put changing tables in the men's restroom?
Well, you know, it's funny. They use this term, and I hate to use it, mandate. That mandate means we'll send men with guns, or we'll take people's justly acquired property if they refuse to capitulate. So, I mean, this is – it's not a bad idea. It's like anything else. I mean, yeah. I mean, I'm sure there are single dads out there who need to change their kids. Okay, that's fine. Well, then start a nonprofit or start some sort of group that says, hey, these are the businesses you should patronize, because if you're a single dad or if you're just someone who cares about this issue – then these places provide facilities. Okay, fine, no problem. But the government sending men with guns to make sure there are changing tables? We're going a little far, aren't we, people?
Dang it, John. You better be able to change your baby in the restroom, or we're going to arrest you.
Well, not me. You'd arrest the place. Or you'd arrest, I don't know what they'd do. They'd fine, I guess, the establishment who didn't have the facilities. You know, it's kind of like with all the ADA requirements.
Why is this even an issue? Why is this even an issue? I mean, I cannot fathom why this is even an issue. Why are we getting government strong arms involved in whether or not businesses have changing tables? It's like you said, if they don't want to provide changing tables in the men's room, they lose out on a specific demographic of business. Period.
Yeah.
The people who do.
Well, you know, Target does this. Target has baby changing tables, and every Target men's restroom I've ever been in, they have a baby changing table. Like a little plastic thing, you pull it down and you can put your kid on it or whatever. So they have those. So they're, I mean, the market already exists for that, you know. I don't quite get it either. I agree with you 100%. I mean, this is lunacy.
This shouldn't even be an issue, quite honestly. Just put them in the bathroom, make them come standard, and then nobody has an issue. And if men need them, they are there. If men don't need them, they're still there for the people who do. It's ridiculous.
Well, you know, they'll have a ribbon cutting ceremony with the with the governor, and they'll invite all these activists who lobbied for the bill, and they'll talk about how wonderful it is, and they'll take their pictures, and they'll talk about how great it is and how this makes for a more civilized society to send men with guns to institute someone's vision of that society. And everybody will feel good about themselves and just feel wonderful, and it'll still be BS.
I already
this is what these people
so,
do.
I already feel so much better about myself just because you said that. Thank you.
We should all feel good about ourselves. Anytime the government passes a law that requires men with guns to force us to do things against our will, we should celebrate.
Yeah. You've already made me feel better about myself. Like my self-esteem has been boosted times 500 just because you mentioned government and feeling good about myself in the same sentence. It works. It really does.
Then you're a natural-born activist, because that's what activists today feel good about. When they get a government law, when they get the gang that has the monopoly on violence in their corner, good times.
You know what? My mom always has told me that I do sarcasm really, really well.
So what's next?
I came across this list. While we're talking about people's rights, the 8 biggest lies that men's rights activists spread about women. I'm really interested in hearing your feedback on this list. I do want to remind people we have a chat room. Please come join us at freedomizerradio.com. There's a chat room tab off to the right. Click on it. Join us in the chat room. I'm in there right now. I want to give a shout out to my friend Liberty Phoenix, who I actually broadcast with on Monday nights on his podcast. Hello, Liberty. Glad you're listening. And also let people know that we have a call-in line. Our call-in line number is 347-324-3704. If you missed tonight's broadcast on Freedomizer Radio, go on YouTube to the Voluntary Virtues Network, where we will have a syndicated version of our episode from 4 to 6 p.m. Eastern Standard Time. So we have a lot of options. However,
but don't try to call in on Thursday, because you can only call in tonight.
That's what syndicated is. And I'm not being facetious. I'm being serious. That anybody who doesn't know syndicated, that's what syndicated means. So it'll be a rebroadcast on the Voluntary Virtues Network. But we still hope that it'll have you listen to us on Wednesday so you can interact with us. We'd be very glad to have some interaction. So, okay. The 8 biggest lies that men's rights activists spread about women. First of all, I had no idea that there was a men's rights movement. Call me ignorant, I don't know, but it's always been women's rights, women's rights, women's rights. Men have a rights movement, apparently. Did you know about this? Do you take any responsibility or take any action with these people? Do you know anything about this, John Moreland?
Well, I know a little bit about it. Actually, when I went through my divorce and my kids and, you know, separation and child support and child visitation and all this stuff, and I went through this a couple of years ago, I thought I was the only guy going through it. And this was, this is about 10 years ago. This is more than 10 years ago now, about 15 years ago. And so I got on the internet and started finding all these other men who were kind of going through the same things. Their wives were – ex-wives were psychopaths, and they would use their kids against them as weapons, even though they had mandatory visitation rights and they had joint custody. Their wives would – or ex-wives would try to withhold their children. And so at that time, there was starting to – I guess there were rumblings of men's rights groups starting, because if you go back and you look, in the majority of cases, in all cases, women get the children and men don't. Men are stuck with child support and alimony, if not both, at least child support. And there's all these other different things that are going on. And so – more and more, I mean, I think it's getting to the point where there's almost a need for it. Now, men really do get screwed in the system. I've been through it personally. I've seen it firsthand, where the women get away with murder. I mean, they get a lot of women get child support every single month, and there is no accounting for that money. They don't have to show where that money went. It's completely – they can spend it on crack if they want to. They have no responsibility for it. On the other hand, if you don't pay it, they throw you in jail. So the woman has a guaranteed subsidy of her income no matter what she does, granted by a privilege of government. And now, you know, let's be real. Most divorces today aren't from abuse or neglect or whatever else. Most divorces today are just irreconcilable differences. So basically, under the situation that we have now, a woman can treat her husband like complete garbage. He can pay for his child's third birthday party where he's hired Bobo the Clown, can walk into his living room and his wife is having sex with Bobo the Clown. She'll get the house, she'll get the kids, she'll get the cars, she'll get it all. And on top of that, he'll pay her every month, and Bobo can even move in with her, and he'll still have to pay her because the government will mandate it. And you know what? All the women's rights activists will line up and say this is totally fair and just, but it's not. So anyways, let's hear this article because I'm really curious about this.
I would just love to say that I hope that the wife, soon-to-be ex-wife, and Bobo don't have children because I would not like to have a child with wildly curly red hair and a big red nose.
That would be bad.
I couldn't resist. I'm sorry.
But you know what? There's nothing you can do about it.
To be quite honest with you, though, I disagree with one thing about you. Sometimes, yes, that can happen. Yes. But when a spouse cheats on the other spouse, that is something to bring up in court. That's infidelity, and that's a major thing when deciding situations like divorce and custody. So while it's possible,
right, but
yes,
you have
but
to
I
prove
think,
that, and the practical side of that is very difficult. It's not as easy as you think. You have to come out of pocket with money to hire a private investigator to take pictures and to do all this other kind of stuff. So from a practical standpoint, most people just cite irreconcilable differences, and that's that.
The list, it says that number one, feminists hate men and are out to turn the world against them. No. People who practice feminism simply want to be treated equal to men. They don't hate men. But the thing is that, like any other fringe group or group, there are people who take it to extremes. Those people give a whole movement a really, really bad name. Yes, there are some who hate men, but the whole idea in general of feminism is not that they hate men. They just wanted to be treated equal.
Well, I'm a male chauvinist pig, so
I'm not
like
gonna
nothing,
comment to that.
Nothing gets me going more than seeing a woman in the kitchen, barefoot, baking something, cooking something, you know, maybe sweeping something up. Nothing gets me going. Doing housework, folding clothes. You don't talk about getting me hot? Folding clothes. Makes me crazy.
Okay, number two, feminists are hypocrites because chivalry is a female privilege. I disagree. Let me tell you about this. To me, yes, it's polite when a man opens the door for me, but it's equally as polite for me to hold the door open for anybody who's coming behind me.
No, wrong. Absolutely wrong. Okay, I'm just going to say this, all right? I was sitting in a Chick-fil-A, a couple years ago, and I'm eating my sandwich or whatever, and in walks this young kid, probably, 16, 17 years old, okay? He walks through the door, obviously his girlfriend behind him, he doesn't even hold the door for her.
Wrong.
What's wrong with this kid? He just let the door close on her face, and then she opened her own door. All right, I'm sorry. I don't care what these crazy feminists say. Men are supposed to be men, and they're supposed to take care of women. That's what we're supposed to do. All right, now, I know I was joking about women doing house duty and stuff like that, and I do like that. Nothing wrong with that. But on the other hand, I do think there's a certain responsibility from tradition that is expected of men to act a certain way. This isn't political. This is different. This is not political. Now, if you don't want to act like that, I'm not going to send men with guns to force you to open the door for a woman. But come on. It's like I was in Starbucks the other day, and there was an older gentleman in there, and there was a pregnant lady trying to get in the door. And, of course, he opened the door and made sure she got in and took care of her. And I was like, now that's a Southern gentleman. That's the way men are supposed to be.
I think some of it applies to things that men should do for women. Pulling out chairs for people. I think it looks weird I just think it looks weird for a woman if she were to pull out a chair for a guy. Plus, I think the guy would feel demasculinized in a restaurant or something if they did that.
Absolutely.
I do think, yeah, so I think like something like that, I agree with you. But if it's opening doors, I hold the door open for anybody who's coming in behind me because I don't see that as an act of chivalry. That's just minding your manners.
No way. If a man is there and a woman opens the door for, or if a woman is there and a woman opens the door for me, I cannot tell you anything that offends me more than having a woman open my door. I'll open your door.
I'm not talking about if you're going into a. I'm not talking about if you're sitting in a car. If you're sitting in a car and come over and open the door for me, absolutely. Thank you for standing up and being a man because. Again, we're talking about pulling out chairs. That's weird.
See,
for a woman
Nina
for
gets
a man.
The golden treatment. Nina gets the golden treatment.
But look, if I'm
she
walking
does.
Into a if I'm getting if I'm walking into a convenience store, you happen to walk behind me and I'm opening the door and you can't grab it quickly enough to let me in first, dude, I'm gonna hold the door open for you. I'm not gonna let it slam in your face. The holding door thing, I think it's just polite. I don't care about so-called rules, but I don't want to do anything that's going to make a man feel inferior by, like, opening his door for him or pulling out his chair. That's just weird. To me, that is just weird. But holding a door open, like going into a building, that's different.
Yeah, no, I mean, I can see that. But, you know, for the most part, I think there are certain things men are expected, especially – us being in the South, I mean, there are certain things we expect. And I know, you know, it's funny. There's been this debate going around the internet about thick libertarians versus thin libertarians and all this stuff. And I don't want to get into the whole debate. But, I mean, basically, there are some of these libertarians out there. They're almost becoming a bunch of leftists. They want to attack everything, even when a tradition is good. And I'm not necessarily for or against tradition. I'm for tradition if you can – logically, if logic and reason says that this – if you can make an evaluation, say, this is a good tradition. Not every tradition should be upheld. But if in your own mind you come to the conclusion this is a good, honorable, and decent tradition, there's no reason to reject it simply because it's tradition. But you've got these crazy left libertarians running around out there saying that, you know, we've got to eradicate – everything that's tradition because everything is racist and everything is sexist. And even if it doesn't mean to be sexist, I mean, I've heard left libertarians say that holding a door open for a woman is sexist because it makes a woman inferior. I mean, it's just lunacy.
No,
I mean,
that is crazy.
Well, it's the same thing with the left that the left went through a couple of years ago. Everything was racism. Everything was sexist. Not that the left still doesn't claim that. But we've got some so-called quote-unquote libertarians now who are saying basically the same thing. But what they don't understand is if they're ever going to reach the world they want to reach, they're only going to be able to do it through force and violence, which completely nullifies anything they believe as a libertarian. Because that's kind of basically what we're against, violence and coercion. Self-ownership, non-aggression principle. If you don't believe in the non-aggression principle and self-ownership, don't call yourself a libertarian. Because that's in essence what it is.
Wow. Some
Much
strong points here. Well, the next one we talked a little bit about in the first one, but number three is the courts are biased against men and in favor of women in custody disputes. Now, before I let you sound off on this one, I want to bring up some statistics that they pointed out in this article. It says that women, while it's true that women more often get custody, it's far more complicated than a systematic bias that turns dad into the real victims of custody battles. It says most disputes are settled out of court, meaning that custody placement does not rest in the hands of judges. Just 4% of cases actually go to trial. Mothers often get custody in large part because, on average, they're still the primary caretakers of children. That's not bias. It's not even necessarily a good thing. It's just a fact. It says that oft-cited statistics that only 10 to 15% of fathers are granted sole custody are skewed because they include couples who have agreed to grant the mother custody or to joint custody. So when men do seek primary physical custody in a disputed divorce, about 50% get it.
Now, they might actually – I'll give them this. They might actually have a valid point. What I think is really interesting there is they're willing to dig deep and ask those questions, whereas in other issues, they're not willing to dig as deep and try to parse out what's real and what's not. But I will say this. A lot of times men feel as if the women are going to get the custody anyways, so therefore they give it to them. And that is because of the system. Now, what percentage that is, we don't know. We don't know what that percentage is. I know I felt that way when I felt like I was in a meat grinder, what I was going through personally. But I know I've talked to other men who have gone through something similar, and they felt like, and to a degree, some men feel like it's better for the children to be with a woman. I don't necessarily have a problem with that if that's what people do voluntarily. But if it's so great and wonderful, then let's make it all voluntary. No more judges. What happens is they go to an arbiter, and they come to a voluntary arrangement. Go to arbitration then. And see, this is where it all typically breaks down. When you go to these people who are typically the left and you say, okay, fine, if this is so great and wonderful and there's no problem here, then let's make it voluntary. Oh, no, 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 we can't do that. You know why? Because they need it. If they don't have force, they need the threat of force to accomplish what they want to accomplish. And that's what we find most of the time. That's what I find with these people. I got into a debate with a leftist a couple weeks ago, and she's talking about how great and wonderful the taxes were and how they went to everything and blah, blah, blah. And I said, well, if these programs are so great and wonderful, let's make the tax voluntary in the United States. Oh, no, no, we can't do that. I said, well, why not? It's so great. You believe in it so much you can convince others to pay the voluntary tax. No, no, there's evil, selfish people who won't pay for it. I said, so what you're saying is you believe not enough people will pay for it in great enough numbers, so therefore that gives you the right to steal from people. Of course she would not say that. She wouldn't give me that, but that's where we ended up. And you know, with these custody battles, the men know.
Oh, you know what? I hear music.
Why do you hear music? I hear music.
Apparently, I'm not really sure why.
Did you hit the music button?
We're going to go ahead and go to a promotion break. We'll be right back.
You know the Constitution like the back of your hand. You've read books, listened to podcasts, attended lectures, surfed websites, and watched videos. You've made liberty your life's goal, but something seems to be missing. Stickers from LibertyStickers.com. Exercise your freedom of speech with the world's most dangerous bumper stickers. That's LibertyStickers.com. But wait. There's more. You can buy Liberty stickers wholesale. Get them for 99 cents each when you put 100 or more in your shopping cart in any combination. Sell them or give them away. They're great for gun shows, flea markets, fairs, outreach, and more. Earn extra money, promote freedom, and spread the word. Need custom stickers, labels, or decals for your organization or business? Liberty Stickers makes them. Go to LibertyStickers.com to order or call 877-873-9626. LibertyStickers.com, the world's most dangerous stickers.
Play on, play that. Play on, play that. Yo, Drake drops the verse.
I like the way you grow it. No pesticides. I got to box it up. I like the way you grow it. So locally, I got to box it up. I like the way you grow it. With no GMOs. I like the way you twerk it. No diggity. No doubt.
We've got squash and peas, calling it a pack for all your bees. Melons you want to squeeze. Yes, please. Yes, please.
Hey, now that plant looks good.
Hey, oh, hey, oh, hey, oh.
I want to grow it.
Mm-hmm.
2014. Search YouTube for Freaks of the Garden. PeacefulBelly.com. Support your local organic farmers.
And we're back. I had a little technical difficulty there. John Moreland, are you still here with me?
I'm still here.
Awesome. Sorry about that, folks. We're having some thunderstorm issues, and I'm having some sound. I had some sound problems, but I'm still here. So, John, before the break, we were talking about the 8 biggest lies that men's rights activists spread about women. And we were on number 4, which states that male circumcision is just as bad as female genital mutilation. Do you know anything about the female genital mutilation?
No comment on this one. I'm gonna skip this one. I'm gonna let you comment on this. I'm out.
This is a major, major problem over in Africa. And I know that the circumcision beliefs about guys in the United States, it's a varying belief between people who think that they shouldn't do that to young men and they should do that to young men, or it's a personal decision or whatnot. But in Africa, to keep women from being able to get pregnant or even enjoy sex, they make some major, major changes to the women's anatomy, which in a lot of cases leads to infection. It leads to possibly even death. You can get prolonged bleeding, infection, cysts, childbirth complications, infertility, and death. So,
I don't even want to know what they do. I don't want to know.
I know. I'm not gonna even discuss it. It is it's pretty heinous and disgusting. So I'll just say, as a woman, I don't know anything about male circumcision, you know, how it feels or anything, of course. So I won't say anything about that.
Real bad.
I think it should be a guy's decision, not the family's, not the parents. So number 5, avoiding conscription is a female privilege. It says that only men are eligible for the draft is an old standby used to derail arguments, male privilege. You think women should be allowed to be in the draft?
Well, no, I think it's funny that they say it's used to derail the argument, but they don't deny that it's true. So I think that's real selective of them. It's absolutely true. No, I don't want to change that, but also don't, and the same token, don't act like we're all privileged. There are certain responsibilities to being a male, you know, and I'm not particularly religious, but the Bible does say that the man is the head of the household, right? If you're religious, if you're a Christian. It says man's head of the household. And that can be interpreted several different ways. But I think it's interesting that it goes on to say, yet, husbands, love your wives as you would love the church. I'm paraphrasing here. I'm not a theologian or whatever. But I'm just trying to make the point that even in Christian belief, the man has certain rights or certain quote-unquote privileges, but they don't come without responsibility either. And so I think it's interesting that they say, well, that's an argument they use, but then they don't say it's not true because it's absolutely true. So what do you think about that?
I don't really know. I think, it's a personal decision. If the women
Do you think women should get conscripted as men do? It should be completely equal that, hey, you girls have to sign up at 18? Or, well, not sign up, but, you know, fill out the draft card?
No, I don't think they should. I don't think men should have to fill her draft card either, though. But unfortunately, that's
absolutely
under,
now that we agree on.
Under the law that we're under, we're screwed. That's all I can say to that. I don't think anybody should.
Yeah.
No,
I agree with you. The state should not be allowed to conscript people into the army.
I agree. And number 6 is men's media depiction is worse than women's. You watch Game of Thrones, you watch all these shows. Is it worse? Do you think that men's media depiction is worse than women's?
I think pop culture shows are that I've seen, yeah. Men are typically played up as boobs and just retards, and they're one of the children, and they're maybe a little bit smarter than the dog. You know, I mean, you know, I think men are inundating with these images. He's drinking beer. He's fat. He plays video games all day. He's not particularly intelligent. He's not interested. He's not well-read. You know, of course, in most sitcoms, you got the girl on the chair reading a novel, and the guy playing, you know, PlayStation and drinking beer and farting. And so I think there is some truth to that. I think men are disparaged now in most pop culture. Would you disagree with that?
I think in some cases, you're right. Like I said, I don't watch a lot of television. I think it depends on what you're watching. But they give a picture of, what's the man's name who played Walter White? Bryan Cranston? Is that his name? Bryan Cranston?
Yeah, the brilliant actor. What is his name? Because I just want to call him Walter White.
Right, I think his name is Bryan Cranston, right?
He is brilliant.
And
I think so.
They're showing a picture of him in his role in Malcolm in the Middle, and he's got ketchup and mustard all over his head and his tie, and they're trying to show him as a bumbling dad.
Yeah, you're right. It's Bryan Cranston. He's not a bumbling dad in Breaking Bad, Walter White.
That was one of my favorite shows,
and they were perfect. I think it was six seasons. It was five or six seasons, and it was beautiful. I mean, it was beautiful the way they did that show.
That is something that I need to catch up on, too. I tried to watch the first episode, and I just couldn't get into it, and I don't know why.
Oh, go through the first, like, five episodes. Once you get about episode five or six, I'll say this about Game of Thrones. Game of Thrones, I watched the first four or five episodes, and I'm like, I don't really get it. I don't dig it. And I was talking with somebody, and they were through season one, and they said, listen, try it again. Get to about the seventh or eighth episode when everything you've learned about all these characters will start making sense, and you'll really enjoy the show. And I did. I went back on his advice, on a friend's advice, and watched it and just absolutely love the show now.
Sometimes you have to get a little time to look into that. Yeah, I'll certainly have to.
Yeah, I think Breaking Bad was six seasons.
Okay.
Six seasons.
Okay, gives me something else to watch.
Have you ever seen that show? Have you ever seen the movie where Jim Carrey gets his mind erased, and he ends up falling in love with the same girl again? Eternal Sunshine of the Spotless Mind.
Yeah. I own that.
I wish I could go back and wipe my brain and watch Breaking Bad again for the first time and know nothing. That's how good that show is.
Okay, I will take that to heart. That will be the next on my watch list. Number seven on this list is false rape allegations are endemic.
They happen, and they happen quite frequently. I don't remember the statistic, but – and I'm saying this on the very, 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 very conservative side. It's 30% or more. I think it's closer to 40%, but I'll say 30 to be on the safe side. It's massive.
No, 2 to 8%, it says. This article says
2 to 8%. That's not the statistics I've seen. So do your own research. Let's say that it's 5%, somewhere between 2 and 8, right? So that means 5 out of 100 men are falsely accused of raping someone.
Do I think
five
that's
out of 100
right?
men?
Absolutely not. Of course,
that's
I don't
horrific.
Think it's right. Yeah, it is horrible. These men will lose their time in their lives that they have to spend if they get convicted in another government mandated prison or jail. Yeah, you're
or
right.
Or what
it's
if they're
horrible.
Not even convicted, but their wife thinks maybe they did it, and they lose their wife and their child and everything. I mean, who knows? I mean, this stuff is very damaging. I mean, I don't know what the statistics are. According to what they're looking at, but the numbers I've seen have been pretty high, scary high.
The final one on this list is that feminists want to turn everything into rape. I don't think that that's a fair statement. I don't think that's fair at all. Remember, this is called the 8 biggest lies that men's rights activists spread about women, and I don't think that's true at all. I don't think that they want to turn everything into rape. It's just rape is horrific. It is horrible.
Well, I mean, I think what they're saying is that the accusation is that all feminists want to turn everything into rape. But there have been feminists who've been quoted, extremist feminists, who says every interaction, every sexual interaction between a man and a woman is rape because the man is physically more dominant. Therefore, it can never be consensual. Now, we can get off on all sorts of philosophical discussions, and I'd love to have that with people, but I think that's a load of crap. But we can be philosophical about it.
No, I think it's a load of garbage too, and I don't like to talk in those terms. I know it happens, I know it exists, but I don't think that we should make a bigger issue out of it than it already is. It's a huge issue because we run into things like people throwing the word around way too much. You know, I think it's a sad thing, but there is a very gray line between, in my opinion, there's a lot of gray area between what is rape and what is not. And it's too easy to pull that out and use that when it certainly might not be the case.
I agree. What's next? Because we got 14 minutes.
Well, you know, talking about misconceptions and misunderstanding and talking about how hard it is to read signs, I found this article this week called "We're All Terrible at Flirting." I don't know about you. I don't know about your flirting skills. I personally don't want to know about your flirting skills. No offense. I love you as a co-host.
Nina would say that they are fantastic.
Okay, well, you know, I hope that she's not telling you that, and then in her head she thinks, well, he tries. He really does.
What? But hey, it obviously works. Hello?
But you see, in our world, if you just utter the words Ron Paul, somebody's automatically turned on. That's just how that is.
Oh, okay. Maybe that was the trick there.
I guess
so
it is.
What's with this?
This says that from the University of Kansas press release, the first study brought together 52 pairs of single heterosexual college students. The pairs of strangers sat alone in a room and talked for 10 to 12 minutes in what they thought was a study on first impressions. At the end of the study, the students were asked to fill out questionnaires in separate rooms. Among other things, students had to note if they flirted and if they thought their counterpart had. So 80% of the group were able to accurately identify when someone wasn't flirting. Only 36% of men and 18% of women could tell that their partner was being flirtatious. It said in one particularly tragic pairing, both the man and woman said that they're flirting with their partners, but neither of them thought that they were being flirted with back. This is interesting to me because I am one of these women who, if a man is not showing me signs of interest, I think he is. And if he does, chances are I'm not going to read them. And then if he is showing them, they're usually coming on way too strong for me. So I am one of these who is utterly confused. And as far as flirting, while I'm outgoing as a person, I'm way too shy and afraid of rejection to flirt with somebody unless I'm sure that they're flirting with me.
I have been called a flirt in the past, but I don't know. I think I probably would be told now that I'm way too serious. So who knows? But you know what? Men and women make it work somehow. There's all these babies in the world. Somebody made flirting work at some point.
This is
or they just said, hey, you suck at it, but you're good enough.
Well, this is an interesting article though, because this isn't saying that men or women are better. They're putting them on equal footing and saying in general. It says that Hall had more than 250 people watch 6 1-minute video clips of those in the first study interacting. It said just one person was shown at a time. The third-party observers were not any more accurate in detecting flirting than those taking part in the interaction. When flirting didn't occur, they were 66% accurate. When it did, they were 38% accurate. So in other words, your chosen wing person is probably not doing their job, but the research findings also said that the lowest accuracy rate was found in females observing males flirting. They identified the flirting just 22% of the time. Both men and women had an easier time detecting when females were flirting, and Hall said that could be because women tend to be more transparent. I'm not sure about the transparency part. I'm not sure about the transparency part because most men that I see, unless it's more of the television and media depiction, that men just come right out and are like, bam, to the face.
No, I think that's media depiction. I think a lot of men try to flirt and be kind of subtle about it. But, you know.
Well, and correct me if I'm wrong, too. I know a lot of men, too, who are more afraid of rejection than women. I know a lot of women who, if they're hurt, they will get back up on that horse, and they will go over and over and over and over and over again trying until they find the right person. I know some men that get hurt once, and they're out of the game for life. I'm not exaggerating.
Yeah, I
either.
Think there's too much of this idea women have in their heads that somehow men are bulletproof and we don't have any feelings and blah, blah, blah. And we may not express them like women do, but they're there, you know. So I think that's the case.
I appreciate a man who can put his feelings out on the table and he can keep going and don't let rejection take over. And I feel sympathy for the guys who do, you know, who get stuck in those positions. It's not easy. And there are women out there like that, too. I feel for them, too. But flirting and the whole game of wooing and dating, it's a very sticky ground. I mean, somebody posted something that were like different perceptions of dating or something. A person's perception controls whether or not a person is considered too clingy or stalkish. I mean, think about it. If somebody is totally into a person and that other person is showering them with attention and showing them a lot of time, well, of course that person's not going to be a stalker. They're not going to be clingy because that person enjoys them and likes them. But if that person likes them and they're not returning it, then that person is now perceived as clingy or stalkish. Just with a matter of perception, it looks completely different.
Yeah, these relationships are it's a messy business.
It is. And then once we get past the wooing and once we get past the dating and courting, then we don't – a lot of people don't understand that once you quote-unquote win the prize, you still have to make this relationship work. It's not you won and it's over. If you want a real relationship that's going to last, you have to work at it. And a lot of people don't realize that these days.
Yeah, I mean, it is something that people have to be aware of. But I think it's just natural. I think a lot of people get lazy. They get complacent. They take things for granted. They do.
I agree. And I think that is the problem today. And I'm not pointing any fingers at anybody. I want to make this clear. But I think that's the problem today with a lot of people in marriage. I think people like the concept of marriage and they really want to be married. But once they're married, they don't understand how much work it takes to put into it, and it turns them off.
Yeah. Well, you know, today it's just easier to bail when you get married. Yeah, I mean, because divorce is easy. It's simple.
Oh, except it's expensive. But the thing is, too, is that we run into a situation again where people, if they want to get married, they have to have consent of the government, and they shouldn't have to get consent of the government to show love and affection to a significant other and want to spend their life with them.
No, but, you know, the government brings in a lot of tax revenue that way. I mean, they call it a licensing or marriage fee or whatever, but it's another tax. It's a way of bringing in more money.
You know, I think that also, I don't know, you know, if you have a child and you're not married, it's out of wedlock. The child is considered quote unquote illegitimate, which is not, it's not fair to the kid. The child by no means is illegitimate. It's just the fact that with the laws that society have let happen, that the government has created, then we have all these terms to define things that are negative to family, that are negative to children. And I mean, it's just another example. In the past, when you got married, a marriage union was simply somebody writing it in the family Bible and acknowledging that it happened, and bam, you're married. I'm not sure really when the licensing started occurring, but it's like you said, it's just another way to bring in revenue. Do you think that more people would be willing to join in a union of some kind if we didn't have to go through the government?
You know, that's a point I've never heard made, but possibly, I mean, maybe more people would decide to marry if they didn't have to deal with, you know, the government hoops, and then, I don't know, who knows? I mean, you know, it's like a free society, you never know what you're going to get, but at least people are entering into things because that's what they want to do, and they're not being coerced in any way or being discouraged in any way. And maybe there's some discouraging. I mean, I know a lot of people, if they got divorced, wouldn't want to wait a year. So why get married? Just go ahead and just shack up because that's simpler. You know, like in South Carolina, you have to wait a year. I know not all states are like that, but.
Well, I know a lot of people, too, who look at marriage, the end of a marriage is failure. But I have two friends who acknowledge that when two people get divorced or separate, it could be just the ending of that relationship. Too many people say, oh, well, you know, we had to get a divorce. It was a failure. And then my friends would chime in and say, no, maybe you were just supposed to be with that person to learn something from them. And whatever you learned, you learned it, and it's time to move on. But the society, especially religious groups, they don't view marriage like that. They view marriage as a joint unity in front of God, in front of your government, signing a piece of paper, and it's meant to last forever. But even science shows will tell you that men were never created to be in one relationship because mentally men were created to go out and populate the world with women.
I can go along with that.
Well, of course you would. It's appealing to your masculine instincts.
Okay, now that we've got 4 minutes left, what are we going to do now? Because we've got 4 minutes.
Well,
I know there's never enough time.
Well, since you really want to talk about Harrison Ray, you said he has another album coming out. Any information or news on when that's going to happen?
No, I haven't seen Harrison in a couple months. When I see him next time, I'm going to talk to him about that. Plus, he's supposed to come out with a acoustic version, a really, really stripped-down version of the first album. He's talking about doing that, too. I think he's actually finished with that. So we'll see what happens. So
I'm very excited to
three or four stories that I wanted to get to tonight because there's never enough time.
Yeah, so we're going to have to join us again. You're going to have to join us again next week, and we're going to have to talk about those articles next week. I do want to give a shout-out to Proof Negative. His show is on next, the Proof Negative Show. It's always on Freedomizer Radio, Monday through Thursday, for 3 solid hours. You never know what he's going to talk about, what guests he's going to have on. That is from 9 till 12 Eastern Standard Time, which is 6 to 9 Pacific Standard Time. Well, there's shows and the times trip me up. But I also want to remind everybody that if you missed tonight's show or you just want to listen to it again, John and I are going to be on the Voluntary Virtues Network every Thursday from 4 to 6 Eastern Standard Time. That is 4 to 6 is 1 to 3. Yeah, 1 to 3 Pacific Standard Time. And that is Voluntary Virtues Network on YouTube.com, which, like we said earlier, I'm interested to see what's going to happen when they start selling the Music Pass program, and we'll see if that affects our network in any way. But I want to thank everybody for listening this week. Thanks to the members in our chat room that listen to us. Thank you for our guests that called in. We're going to end actually with another song by Harrison Ray. This is called Bells, and we'll see you guys next week.